Okay, welcome to the 21st meeting of 2022, Session 6 of the Equalities, Human Rights and Civil Justice Committee. First item on our agenda is consideration of 6 negative instruments. I refer members to Paper 1. The instruments are Justice of the Peace Courts Fees Scotland Order 2022, Sheriff Court Fees Order 2022, High Court of Judiciary Fees Order 2022, Sheriff Appeal Court Fees Order 2022, Adults with Incapacity, Public Guardians Fees, Scotland Regulations 2022, Court of Session, etc. Fees Orders. Do any members have comments on any of these instruments? I see Pam Duncan-Glancy.
Thank you, Convener. I'm concerned that the instruments up the cost for accessing justice by 2% in July and a further 2% next April, at a time when disabled people and many others are facing extreme cost of living increases. And some of the evidence that was submitted to the consultation on the increases has highlighted that the exemptions and the disregards for some income, including for disabled people, are not sufficient to ensure access to justice and protect against poverty. So I remain quite concerned about the increases, and I note the concerns of organisations such as Inclusion Scotland, Citizens Advice Scotland and others.
Thank you. Any further comments, Maggie?
Thanks, Joe. I'm wondering whether this is something that we can raise with the Minister when we see her in September. Is she coming in September? Or maybe write a letter, because I think there are two things. There's not only the uplift, but there's also the threshold limit. And I'm wondering whether we can have a discussion about that, maybe not obviously for the July uplift, but certainly in advance of April, and having some conversations with her about that would be helpful, I think.
Rachel?
I'd also like some clarification around the exemption from court fees for those in receipt of personal independence plan and adult disability payment with a gross annual income of 20,592. And I also think that we need some clarification around the impact of inflation. It does make reference to that, but perhaps that inflationary pressure should be looked at sooner rather than later.
Okay, these are all matters that we can discuss in private, and we can either agree to write to the Minister or indeed make sure that we're seeing her early in September. For today, there is no scope for us to get the Minister in front of us as the negative instruments come into force, but obviously if any member wants to take any further action, if they discuss that with the clerks, there is obviously a parliamentary process. All that being said, and all of those points on record, are we content formally not to make any comments to the Parliament on these instruments? Okay, that being the case, that concludes consideration of the SSIs, and we'll suspend briefly. OK, thanks very much. The next agenda item is to continue taking evidence on the Gender Recognition Reform Scotland Bill. Before we start our formal evidence session, I'd like to put on the record our thanks to a number of groups who have engaged with us privately over the last week or so to give us their views on the bill. Anonymised notes of those sessions will be published in due course. So we'll now continue our formal evidence taking, and I'd like to welcome to the meeting Shona Robison, Cabinet Secretary for Social Justice, Housing and Local Government, and officials Peter Hope-Jones, Head of Gender Recognition Unit, and Colin Gilchrist, Solicitor in the Scottish Government. And I refer members to papers 2 and 3, and we'd invite Cabinet Secretary to make a short opening statement.
Okay, thanks very much, convener, and morning, everyone. For nearly two decades, the Gender Recognition Act has provided a route to legal recognition for trans people. However, evidence shows that the process can be lengthy, invasive and demeaning. Since it was introduced, the World Health Organization has recategorised gender identity health, making clear that being transgender is not a condition of mental ill health, and classifying it as such can cause distress. Only around 6,000 people of an estimated 500,000 trans people in the UK have a gender recognition certificate or a GRC. The aim of the Gender Recognition Reform Bill is to reform that process, bringing it more in line with the current understanding and international best practice, and to remove barriers to trans people accessing their existing rights. I know that there are deeply held views on transgender issues, and I do appreciate that reservations about the bill are often connected with legitimate concerns about the violence, abuse and harassment that women and girls face in our society. As I've said before, trans people are not responsible for that abuse and often face it themselves. I'm also aware that many view these reforms as vital and overdue. It's important to focus on the reforms that are contained in the bill as introduced, and to be very clear about what the bill does. The bill introduces a new process for obtaining a GRC, open to those born or adopted in Scotland or ordinarily resident here. It removes the requirement for a medical diagnosis of gender dysphoria, reduces the minimum period of living in the acquired gender from 2 years to 3 months, while introducing a new 3-month reflection period, and lowers the minimum age for applying from 18 to 16. The process of obtaining a GRC would remain a serious and substantial undertaking. Applicants would still have to make a statutory declaration that they are currently and intend to live in their acquired gender for the rest of their lives. Under the bill, offences relating to making a false application carry potential penalties of up to 2 years in prison. Based on international comparison, we estimate that the number of Scottish GRCs might rise from around 30 to between 250 and 300 a year. That is what the bill will do. I know that there has been some misunderstanding around what the bill does not do, and I want to be very clear on that too. The bill does not change the protections set out in the Equality Act. It does not change the exceptions in that Act that allow single-sex services to exclude trans people where that is a proportionate means of achieving a legitimate aim, including where those trans people hold a GRC. The bill does not change or remove women's rights. It does not make changes to how toilets and changing rooms operate. It does not redefine what a man or a woman is, and it does not change or expand trans people's rights. The bill does not change the effect of a GRC, which is that the individual is legally recognised in their acquired gender. The bill does not change the policy or laws of England or any other country. It is for other governments and parliaments to decide how GRCs are recognised in their jurisdictions. The bill does not change the way gender identity healthcare is provided or make changes to public policy, including NHS patient care. It does not alter practices for collecting or processing data, including that relating to crimes. It does not change the way Scottish prisons accommodate the people in their care. And it makes no changes to women's sport, whether professional, amateur or in schools. As the committee has already heard, the development of this bill has involved some of the most extensive consultation ever undertaken by the Scottish Government. I've personally met with a wide range of interested parties, and I know that the committee has also heard from a wide and varied group of organisations and individuals during its scrutiny sessions. Some of those people support the bill and others are opposed, and I'm aware that I'm unlikely to change their minds by anything I have to say today, but that does not mean I haven't listened and considered their views, just as you will do. I do commend the respectful and considered manner of everyone involved in this process. I remain of the view that the reforms set out in the bill strike an appropriate balance in improving access to important human rights, while also providing a robust and serious process not to be undertaken lightly. But I do look forward to hearing the views of the committee based on the evidence heard at the end of your consideration of stage one, and I'm happy to take questions.
Thank you, Cabinet Secretary. We now move to questions, starting with Maggie Chapman.
Thanks very much. Good morning, Cabinet Secretary. Thank you for joining us this morning and for your opening remarks. I've got a few questions around the removal of the diagnosis for gender dysphoria and the gender recognition panel. Firstly, on...
The meeting is suspended.
I'll start again. A couple of questions around the removal of the diagnosis for gender dysphoria and the removal of the gender recognition panel. Firstly, on gender dysphoria, you talked in your opening remarks about the shift away from treating being trans as a mental health condition. And I was wondering what you can tell us, where you think the importance of this lies in separating legal transition from that medical transition.
Yeah, I think the removal and the separating out of the legal and medical elements is important. Obviously, the redefinition from the World Health Organization, I think, has been important for a number of countries that have changed their processes. The evidence that we have heard from those that have gone through the current system under the 2004 Act describes the process as being very demeaning, that the gender recognition panel are a group of people unknown to the person, that they feel it's a very difficult, onerous process. Therefore, we believe, as many other countries have done, that the time is right to move to what is seen as international best practice. There have been a number of countries that I know that the committee will have looked at, Ireland obviously being one of our nearest neighbours, who have moved to this position, and I think just recently, over the last few days, Spain have also announced that they will be moving in this direction as well. So we think it's in line with best practice, and certainly along the lines recommended by the international bodies.
Okay, thanks for that. I'm wondering, we've heard evidence about people who are concerned that removal of the diagnosis potentially opens up the process of applying for a GRC to a wider group of people who may be bad faith actors. But also that it removes that kind of medical diagnosis, and I suppose some of the concerns might be that it takes away from the seriousness of the decision, and I'm wondering what your comments on that are.
Well, it's still a very serious step to take in terms of a statutory declaration. You have to declare that you are going to live the rest of your life in that gender. I think it has been shown over the international evidence that has arisen that there is really no evidence of the changes in those laws being misused by, as you describe, bad actors. I think the evidence given by the Scottish Human Rights Commission was very strong in this area. They can find no evidence of the misuse of this process. There is, of course, quite hefty penalties for misuse, and I laid that out in my opening remarks, that if someone is making a false declaration, essentially they will feel the full force of the law in terms of that.
Helpful. I suppose moving on to the gender recognition panel, that the process of self-declaration obviously removes the need for that. What do you see are the main benefits of removing the panel for trans people going through the process?
Yeah. Well, clearly the reason that so few people in the trans community compared to the number of trans people within the UK, which, as I said in my opening remarks, are anything between, up to 500,000 people. The fact that only 6,000 people have obtained a gender recognition certificate suggests that the evidence that we've heard about the process is really off-putting to people. And therefore, having a process of statutory declaration will enable people to essentially gain the legal recognition of the way that they've been living their lives for many years. Many will have already changed other documentation, and I suspect that the spike that Ireland saw when they changed it to a process of statutory declaration, which then settled down in terms of the numbers after that, but that spike I suspect would be people who had been living in their acquired gender for many, many years and were then taking the step for that legal recognition. One of the most powerful pieces of evidence I heard was someone who was older in years, and the one thing that the most important thing for them in all of this was that they would be able to have their death certificate record the gender that they had lived their entire life in. So for people that this affects, tiny number of people, it can be really, really important for them. And I think for me that highlights how important it's a very personal thing, and to have that end of life being recognised in the gender that you've lived your whole life in was very, very powerful.
Thanks, Shona. And I think we heard similar evidence in a couple of the sessions that we held. I suppose the reverse of that, there are concerns that the removal of any form of gatekeeping or any form of formal safeguards is troubling for some people, especially if it makes it easier for the examples that we've heard given to us relating to prisoners serving sentences for sexual assault, that kind of thing. Are there safeguards or gatekeeping measures that you think we should be considering?
So the prisons is obviously an area that has been raised, and I think you've heard evidence from the Scottish Prison Service. And what they've said is that whether or not someone has a gender recognition certificate doesn't affect the way they risk assess the person. So they've already, at the moment, they place people in the estate that is, whether it's about the safety of themselves or the safety of others, they will place someone in the most appropriate estate, whether or not they have a gender recognition certificate. And I think that is right, and that is reassuring in terms of the process. And we're talking about a tiny number of people here, and I think it's important not to conflate. There is no evidence that there is a higher number of people who are sex offenders within the trans community at all. In fact, the overwhelming evidence is that sexual offences are committed mainly by men on women. That's the overwhelming evidence. But where there are transgender prisoners, for whatever offence, the management of them is down to Scottish Prison Service, and I think they do that very carefully. And obviously they have their review on at the moment as well to make sure that if they need to make any further changes, that review will guide them in that.
Thank you. Final question, if I may. In relation to the role of the Registrar General, who sort of will oversee the administration of this process now, I suppose there's a question around how the government will ensure that the Registrar General is resourced efficiently sufficiently to be able to support people going through the process and any questions, issues they may have. But I suppose there's also something around the regulations that the Registrar General will have the powers to make. And what are the constraints or parameters within which you see those regulations being made?
So the Registrar General will have an important role here, not least in making sure the guidance is clear and supportive in terms of being able to explain in clear language. Now, that guidance obviously will be worked on involving a number of organisations. I know, for example, there's been evidence, I think, from the Children's Commissioner that for 16, 17-year-olds that the language used in the guidance needs to be clear, that there would potentially be also the signposting to other organisations that are beyond the Registrar General's ambit of providing guidance. In terms of the regulations, in terms of any changes, Peter, do you want to maybe just add to that?
Sure. So, firstly, you mentioned costs to the NRS and the Registrar General, and we published a financial memorandum which sets out we do not anticipate huge costs from this because the numbers are expected to be relatively low, as the Cabinet Secretary has already said. We've suggested initial costs of 300 to 350,000 with ongoing annual costs of about 150,000 a year, and those would be met by the Scottish Government. In terms of the power to make regulations, I think the most important thing to stress there is that the powers as set out in the bill allow the Registrar General to kind of tweak the specific process in terms of the information that might be provided. What it doesn't allow them to do is to change the basis on which certificates would be issued. So it wouldn't allow them to reintroduce a requirement for medical evidence, for example, for certificates to be issued. And obviously the bill sets out the process through which those regulations would have to follow. And so if those regulations were making changes to the bill, changes to the legislation, they would have to go through an affirmative process in the Parliament.
Okay, thanks. Okay.
And Rachel Hamilton, please.
Cabinet Secretary, on this point, GRCs that are issued by the Registrar General, will they have a UK-wide effect? Or what is it your intention to do in terms of the information that is passed between registers from here in Scotland to England, Wales and Northern Ireland in terms of issuing a revised birth certificate? What happens in that situation?
So, first of all, in terms of the systems that other parts of the UK have, will be for them to decide, and also whether, in terms of the UK government's recognition of Scottish GRCs, will be a matter for them also.
But England aren't moving to self-declaration, so what happens then?
So there are some fundamental rights that will remain the same that are enshrined under the Equality Act 2010 that are applied to people whether or not they have a GRC. So those would be in kind of everyday your rights at work in terms of any interaction with public bodies. They remain the same whether someone has a GRC or not, because they're protected under the Equality Act 2010. In terms of the specifics of... do you want to pick up?
Yeah, sure. Sure. So the process as it works at the moment is that the Scottish Registrar General can update Scottish birth certificates, and Registrar Generals in England and Wales and Northern Ireland can update their respective birth registers and certificates. So as it works at the moment, applications go to the Gender Recognition Panel. If they're approved by the Gender Recognition Panel, they inform the Scottish Registrar General and they make the update in Scotland. We're proposing the exact same thing. So we would issue gender recognition certificates in Scotland. We would update the birth register or adoption register in Scotland as appropriate, and we would inform Registrar Generals in the respective other administrations. And it would be for those administrations to decide how to act based on that information.
How would you inform them? But do your data systems, are they compatible?
Yes, because that's how it... Currently, it goes the other direction, but yes, the Registrar Generals are in touch, yes.
OK, and have you had a conversation with the UK Government regarding the effect of this bill to the rest of the UK?
Yes, I mean, mainly at official level, Peter can say a little bit more, but there's been ongoing engagement all the way through this bill. Peter, do you want to say a little bit more about the engagement with officials that you've had?
Yes, of course. So, I mean, we regularly meet with and talk with officials down south on specific cross-border issues, but also more generally. So we've had those initial conversations at official level, but the formal Section 104 process and the formal conversations about mutual recognition have not taken place yet, and that's quite normal with a bill that we would not be entering into a formal Section 104 process until... nearing the end of its passage, or indeed after it's passed.
You don't see any risk in not going down that route of considering that you may need a Section 104 order before this bill goes through?
Yeah, we are following the routine process of a Section 104.
Would you advise that this committee takes evidence on that?
Well, that would be a matter for us around the mechanics of the legislation rather than, you know, a part of the bill as such. It's about the mechanics of the legislation once the bill has finished its process through Parliament. And at that point, there's nothing odd about that. It's just the normal course of events. It would be a technical issue, which we don't envisage having any issues.
And you don't see any challenges through the Supreme Court?
No. Whether the UK government changes its own processes is clearly a matter for them, as is whether or not they recognise Scottish gender recognition certificates, and that is a matter that is for them, but it doesn't affect our ability to make changes to the law here.
Can I add one thing? So UK government, in considering this, will the recognition of Scottish certificates will also obviously need to consider how they recognise certificates and gender recognition processes that have been gone through elsewhere in the world. So currently they have processes in place for that, and they have a list of recognised territories and a process for that. That has not been updated for at least a decade, I think. We understood they were in the process of reconsidering that, and I imagine that they will want to think about that alongside that, which is quite a challenging and substantial project.
Okay, thanks.
Okay, thank you. And Pam Gossall, please.
Thank you, Convener. Good morning, Cabinet Secretary. Cabinet Secretary, 59% of those who responded to the short survey were not in favour of the proposed reforms. And in turn, I have received numerous correspondence from individuals who feel their views have not been represented on or heard. In response to this committee, members and particularly clerks have had to make last-ditch attempts to secure witnesses to ensure the scrutiny of the bill is more balanced and include last-minute private sessions out with parliamentary time to ensure that those affected by the bill will be heard from. We've received a large number of additional written evidence in such a short period of time, and there simply has not been enough time to scrutinise such an important bill. Cabinet Secretary, would you agree that stage one has been rushed through and that those affected by the bill, in addition to the committee members and democracy more generally, would be benefited from more thorough throughout an approach with a longer timescale for the evidence sessions, and therefore do you believe that at this stage it would be beneficial to delay stage one of this bill?
No, I don't agree with that. This has been subject to a lot of consultation. There have been two Scottish and one UK consultation, all of which received high numbers of responses. In those consultations, there was generally more support than opposition, but I take the point about the responses to the committee. In addition to that, we've seen various polls that have been done. For example, the BBC poll, which found 60% of the public support reform, with young people and women more likely to support it. More recently, a report from More in Common found that people are perhaps less divided on trans issues than maybe social media would indicate. The two formal consultations were among the largest ever undertaken by the Scottish Government, with over 30,000 responses in total. And work has gone on over a number of years to get us to this point. I have met with organisations both for and against the bill, and during those conversations, which were very wide-ranging, some suggestions for change were made from both sides of the debate, and I've considered all of those. And before that, obviously, my predecessor, Shirley-Ann Somerville, had also met with a range of organisations. So I think this is an area that has been debated, scrutinised, consulted upon, and now we're at the process of looking at the detail, and obviously that is what this committee is doing. So no, I don't think it would be appropriate to pause. I think it's now for this committee to do its work, and I think it's for Parliament to make a judgment about the detail of this bill and whether it supports it.
Thank you for your response, Cabinet Secretary. Just two bits on that. I'm going to go back to your predecessor in a minute, but just talking about what you've said, that we've had such a lengthy a consultation and people being heard. Why do you think that people out there, I mean, certainly, I'm not the first in this committee. I think people have been emailed and things have been voiced from people. Why do you think that they're voicing that they're not, they've not been heard, and that, you know, certainly I can tell you from my experience, it's a very, very tiring experience. You know, last week having three sessions crammed in 1 week, and this week two sessions. And certainly it's been tiring for myself, but also what I would say is for those people listening and those people feeling that they haven't been heard, what would you say to them, Cabinet Secretary? Because this bill is now in stage one, it's going through, you know, so.
Yeah, so on the first point, look, I've sat in committees that have taken lots and lots of evidence, and I guess that's the role and purpose of committees, that, you know, that we sit on and we look at that detail, and we want to hear as many views as possible. I think it's fair to say that there is a body of opinion. This is quite a polarised discussion. I'm not going to pretend otherwise. Of course it is. And we will have been contacted, as you have, I have, by people who are strongly in favour of the bill, but people who are very strongly opposed. I think one of the issues is that sometimes the reasons for people's opposition are actually not to do with the bill itself and the provisions of the bill, but more wider concerns, some of which I'm sure we'll touch on today, some of which I tried to outline in my opening remarks that this bill is not concerned with. I think when it all boils down, we have to be guided by the evidence, and I think the committee has heard some compelling evidence. Some of the evidence heard that was led by the Scottish Human Rights Commission last week, I think, got into the nub of some of these issues about the evidence from countries that have adopted a statutory declaration process. The concerns that perhaps are expressed by people emailing yourself or me have not been found to come to fruition. So sometimes it's the concerns rather than the evidence that those countries have then found once they have these processes in place. And I think the Scottish Human Rights Commission were quite clear they could find no body of evidence that showed that some of those concerns about, you know, threat to women and girls, or, you know, a major kind of change in society as we know it, that did not happen in those countries. And I've got no reason to believe that Scotland would be any different from that. Important, though, that we do the annual reporting on the bill, and I know that the committee have taken some evidence about whether there should be a review, a post-legislative review of the legislation to make sure that there's nothing that is emerging that perhaps we hadn't predicted. I'm very sympathetic to that, and if the committee were to recommend that, then that's something I would give due consideration to, because I think it is important that we do look at the operation of any piece of legislation.
Thank you. I'm still on the same question. Is that okay? No worries. Thank you for that response, Cabinet Secretary. Just going back to, you mentioned your predecessor. Obviously, she announced, at the time, the Cabinet Secretary, announced a delay in June 2019 to take account of additional issues raised since the consultation and sought to build consensus on the way forward. Why then did the Scottish Government only agree to hold meetings with those who opposed the bill between January to March 2022, when it was arguably too late to influence policy? And just on top of that, just additional to that question, what are the points from that in the section of the bill, the concerns that were addressed, have you taken forward?
So I'm aware that Shirley Ann Somerville also undertook a consultation and met with a number of organisations. Peter might, he was closer to this obviously than I am, but as I understand, what emerged from some of that were around the 3-month reflection period was one of the areas that emerged from that, and Peter can maybe say more about that in a second. There's also been ample opportunity for written comments, all of which have been looked at and considered. And I then personally undertook the round of engagement once I came in to post, and once I'd got my head around the expanse and the detail of what is a complex area, undertook my own personal meetings with organisations from both sides of the argument around this bill. And areas that I looked at in a lot of detail, well, one, for example, was whether or not the age should be 18 or 16. I gave that a lot of consideration. I looked at all of the views about it, and as I said in my statement, it was finely balanced because of the differing views. The commitment to annual reporting came directly out of that round of engagement with organisations, because I was being asked, how will you know how many GRCs have been issued? How will you know if there's been a spike? How will you know what the pattern is? And that was an absolutely fair point. So we agreed to put in the annual reporting requirement. The other area that was changed was on cost, because some organisations in favour of the bill said that they thought that having a cost may be prohibitive to people, so we listened and we have we removed cost on that basis. So those two examples that came directly out of that round of consultation. Peter's best place to talk about what happened before that, because obviously I wasn't in post.
But absolutely.
I'm just looking for basically the concerns at that time that were raised by those people and organisations that are they addressed in this bill? So it's good that the Cabinet Secretary mentioned age and a few others, but there are many others that were concerns that people are raising. So it's just on that, that if they've been put in the bill.
Yeah, so I don't think it's the case that Ms Somerville announced the delay to the bill and then there were no meetings with officials. I don't think that's the case. And we've set out in our equality impact assessment the engagement that was gone through. So that when Ms Somerville made that announcement, it was to lead into the second consultation, which was on the full draft bill. And both before that point and during that second consultation, Ms Somerville's having meetings with interested parties. And again, that's set out in the Equality Impact Assessment, so you can see the detail of that there. Obviously, after that second consultation, there was a delay and a period during which there was no meetings going on, and that was because COVID hit us and there was no work on this bill being taken forward at all. on the question of whether those views of those parties were taken on board, I mean, the views expressed in those meetings and in the consultation responses were absolutely considered, but as the Cabinet Secretary's set out, the fundamental core of the bill did not change substantially. The Cabinet Secretary made changes to the bill based on those meetings that she had.
Do you want to bring something in? I've got another question.
Before we go back to Pam Gossip, we'll go to Karen Adam, please.
Thank you, Convener. Cabinet Secretary, I'd like to ask, we've heard a lot of evidence written and oral from, you know, people in favour and people opposed to the bill, and a lot of the concerns of those that have been opposed to the bill have been debunked through these evidence sessions. And what I'd really like to ask is, now that we're perhaps having these calls to delay the bill, as all else has been addressed, what would be the consequences of delaying this bill?
Well, I think we've been a long time getting to this point, and I think any further delay is not going to necessarily enhance the public discourse around these issues. I think it's come to the point where, as legislators and parliamentarians, we need to make a decision about this. And I think any further delay, given all the delays that there's already been, would not be helpful. I think people who are deeply affected by this, and I reiterate, a tiny number of people for whom this is really important, would have further delay in being able to bring their legal status and documentation into line with how they live their lives. And I don't think that would be the right thing to do.
Thank you.
Pam Gossel.
Thank you. Cabinet Secretary, just two more questions just on single-sex bases and a bit to do with religion as well, please. Cabinet Secretary, the committee has heard concerns, obviously you've heard them as well, following the system of self-declaration will open the bill up to abuse by bad faith actors to invade women's single-sex bases. What is your response to those concerns, and will you be considering provisions such as blocking those convicted of sex crimes from obtaining a GRC through self-declaration? And if not, can you tell the committee what the bill does to address the concerns about the safety of women and girls from bad faith actors who may exploit this bill?
So I think the first thing I would say is to point again to the evidence given by the Scottish Human Rights Commission, where they were very clear that there is no body of evidence, at least in the countries that have now got a system of statutory declaration, that points to bad faith actors trying to use this process in order to abuse women and girls. All of the evidence really points that the abuse of women and girls comes from predatory men who there's no evidence of them using a system of statutory declaration for gender recognition in order to abuse women and girls. There's just no evidence of that. In terms of access to single-sex spaces, so as I said in my opening remarks, if the Equality Act 2010 does provide for exceptions, including for trans people with a gender recognition certificate, if those exceptions are proportionate, so the example given under the Equality Act is a service, a counselling service for rape victims, I think it was, that there would be there could be an exception where transgender women would be excluded from that service. Now, other spaces like toilets and changing rooms, which have had obviously a lot of attention in this discussion in the public domain, are areas that have never required and don't require a gender recognition certificate. So the trans community going about their daily lives as they have for forever will use or not use those spaces and have done, and you know, I think if that had been an issue, we probably would have been aware of it before the confines of the debate around this bill. So I think the where single-sex spaces are needing or have a reason to exclude trans people for the reasons that I've outlined, that does not change under this bill at all. That will remain the same, and I think it's important that it does.
Thank you. I've previously questioned how Section 22 interferes with freedom of religion. For instance, where it goes against a woman's religious practices to be touched by a man. So basically, going into doctor surgery, just an example I've mentioned before, is going for a smear test, and in the practice, you can ask for a female doctor. That's quite normal. My own mother does it, you know, and a lot of my relatives and friends. However, given the individual with a GRC do not have to disclose this, there's a possibility that a woman could end up be seen by a biological male. I have been made basically aware of this issue and also the concerns people are having with the existing legislation. But could you... I'm trying to put this in words before... obviously, with the GRA reform, it could be more widespread. And to ask you that, are you aware of this issue existing before this bill and how you seek to address it? Also, giving the balance that's very important to trans rights and giving that balance to religious rights, whether it's single-sex spaces or single-sex services that people, especially from religious background, that they require that service.
So... clearly, I think, as you've alluded to yourself, this is an issue that is not relating directly to this bill. So it's about healthcare, whether it's now or after the bill. And so let me say a couple of things about that. So the NHS try where it can to give people their wishes in terms of if they want a man or a woman in terms of the care, whether it's personal care delivered by social care staff or whether it is, as you said, a smear test or whatever the procedure. So if a patient specifically requests a doctor or nurse of the same gender for whatever reason, then of course the NHS will try to accommodate that as far as possible. There are obviously, there's never any guarantees for that because of the availability of staff with appropriate skills to manage the patient's condition. And I know, for example, in social care, it can be quite difficult when a man requests male social care staff because it's a predominantly female workforce. Sometimes that can be difficult to give grant those wishes. The Patients' Rights Charter tries to set out the preferences, culture, beliefs, values and level of understanding that will be taken into account and respected when using NHS services. So it sets out that, of course, people's wishes will be accommodated where possible. The Equality and Human Rights Commission also have published statutory codes of practice and guidance to help employers understand the relevant issues dealing with some of the issues you raised. There's also the general occupation requirement exception, which can provide that a person appointed must not be a trans person where there is an occupational requirement due to the nature of the context of the work. So there's a lot, I think, of safeguards that you could describe around this area. I think also, just finally, the evidence from the Scottish Human Rights Commission talked about a fair amount of case law about balancing religious rights with, you know, freedom from discrimination, and you know that has, you know, predated this bill. I mean, in terms of someone who, you know, doesn't disclose, I would have thought that is something for the employer to deal with. I mean, we're talking about very hypothetical situations here. I can't imagine that, you know, most people, particularly if they're in the caring professions, would want to do anything other than to have the person's wishes respected. That would be my view of that. And I think employers, guided by the guidance from the EHRC, I think have probably been dealing with these issues for many, many years, particularly the NHS, in making sure people's wishes are respected as far as possible.
Thank you, Cabinet Secretary. Just quickly, just lastly, we heard in a private session from an organisation that talked about that this would drive women, especially women from women and girls from ethnic minority groups, more underground, that the fact that they wouldn't go into single-sex spaces like changing rooms and many other places. Do you believe that would be the case, that if they, you know, can't have that single-sex space to themselves, that this would basically drive them more underground? And also, I welcome the fact that you've said that employers will have that, and they would have that in their, hopefully, employment contracts and guidance, that the trans person, that, you know, you could be sensitive to religious religious grounds, that if somebody wanted to go and see a doctor. So I do welcome that, what you've said. But just on going back to my question, if you could answer that.
So I think the Scottish Human Rights Commission, again, talked about this when you saw them last week, and they said that there's no evidence of widespread self-exclusion from services based on the international evidence of what has gone on in other countries, and, you know, not dissimilar to our own position. And I think there is something about fear and concerns rather than perhaps actual threat, but that's important in itself because we don't want people to be concerned and worried. And therefore, I think we all have a responsibility to be clear with people what this bill does, and, but importantly, almost more importantly, what it doesn't do. So all of the protections, all of that are already in place, you know, are not affected by this whatsoever. I think going back to where the violence against women and girls emanates from, and it is from predatory men. There's no evidence that predatory men feel the need to try to obtain a gender recognition certificate to be predatory and abusive. And of course, GRCs are not necessary to access areas like, you know, toilets, changing rooms, other spaces that are not restricted as they would be for exceptions under the Equality Act. And, you know, as I said earlier on, trans women and trans men will have been using these spaces for many years. And I think we would, had that been a concern and an issue, I think we would have heard about it before now. Having said that, as I said earlier, I'm sympathetic to the not just the annual reporting from in terms of post-legislation, but also if the committee feel that having a review to be able to take stock of all of these issues is important, and if that's a recommendation, that's something that I would look quite favourably upon.
Thank you, Karen. Thanks. And Karen Adams, a brief sum.
Very briefly, Convener, I'm just concerned about some of the language that's been used, and referring to trans women as biologically male has been used in the past as a transphobic dog whistle. So it's just to be aware of the language that we were using, because obviously we're going to have a high volume of trans people who are interested in what's going on at committee today.
Okay, thank you. I'm trying very hard not to police language unless it's directed at an individual, but I think your point is made. Pam Duncan-Glancy, please.
Thank you, Convener. Good morning, Cabinet Secretary and to your officials. This gets to the heart of human rights and is ultimately about the human rights of trans people. And of course, trans people's rights are human rights, not because they're trans, but because they are human. And we've heard in a lot of the evidence sessions about the importance of human rights and everyone's human rights that's involved. And so I am deeply disappointed in the public discourse around this particular debate, where trans people have been able to see opening papers, watching the news and seeing their rights be debated. And, of course, where women have also experienced the same. And human rights are inalienable, not debatable. So my first question, I guess, Cabinet Secretary, is to ask, well, first of all, to say that I believe a lot of that is to do with the vacuum between 2017 and 2019 that was left by the government, and I'm disappointed that vacuum was left. Can you set out what the government can do to sort this mess?
OK. So let me firstly agree that trans rights are human rights, and I think what we're trying to achieve here is I guess, that recognising that, and I think, again, this was really put across strongly by the Scottish Human Rights Commission, that everybody's human rights are all important collectively and should not be seen as somehow in opposition to one another, and I think that is important. In terms of the public discourse, we've already had a discussion this morning about, there should have been more time. So I take your point that you feel there's been too much time, and I think we've probably kind of landed in the middle of, I think it's been well discussed, it's been well consulted upon, and I think we've now got to the position where we're able to look at the detail and make decisions. In terms of the public discourse, very difficult to change what is on social media and in some sections of the mainstream media as well. In some places, it's become perhaps a bit of a wedge issue to against a tiny number of people who are extremely vulnerable and really just want to get on with their lives, which is why this bill is important. In terms of the public discourse going forward, I think that once the legislation is in place and people see that actually the people it affects are the tiny number of people who it directly affects, i.e. those who are going to obtain a gender recognition certificate that can then reflect how they've been living their lives anyway. And I think when you see those other countries growing in number, I cited Spain now looking at it as well, that the actual practice and operation of this, none of the concerns, some of which were expressed in those countries as well, have come to fruition. And I think that should give us some confidence that people will perhaps be assured by that. And then I think finally, as I said in my earlier remarks, I'm not sure that the social media really reflects where public opinion is on this matter. So I mentioned the BBC poll, which actually showed that young people overwhelmingly are more supportive of trans community in all of the polls that are done, but also women were more supportive. And I thought that was perhaps food for thought. So some of the polling that has been done, I think, is perhaps a bit, shows a different views than perhaps social media would have us believe. But we will continue to do, if there's other things we can do to improve the public discourse as a government, or try to, of course we will. And if there are any suggestions from the committee in that regard, then happy to look at those.
Thank you for that answer, Cabinet Secretary. Could you set out what changes you've made and what equalities analysis you've done since the equality impact assessment in 2017 to 2019? We've heard some concerns that there haven't been many changes.
So I can do that. I mean, the impact assessment sets out all of the organisations that were met with, all of the evidence that was looked at. And as I said earlier on, we have reflected on that. And after coming into post and having the meetings, looking at the evidence, I had some key decisions to make, one of which was age. And I had to I looked at that in a lot of detail, and on the basis of the evidence on looking at things like the age of legal responsibility in Scotland, thought that, and the evidence given by young trans people in particular, that that 16 was the appropriate age. The annual reporting, the costs, these are areas that were raised during those discussions. I think the central premise of the bill has remained the same, and that is that, you know, we don't believe in the medical model, so it is a demedicalised model of statutory declaration that is simplified, very similar to that taken forward in other countries. And we've not really moved from that central premise, because that's the central premise of the bill. But what we have done is listen to some of the areas, like I've set out in terms of age, cost, reporting.
Specifically on the consideration of equalities issues sort of since 2019, it's maybe just worth explaining that process of developing the impact assessments was an ongoing process that didn't finish in 2019. So we've gone through quite an unusually detailed and robust process around the impact assessments, which is that we, in the first 2017 consultation, we set out kind of the general principles of that process. In the 2019 consultation, we've published a full draft impact assessment. And since then, we absolutely have continued considering those issues. We've updated the impact assessments, but it's all been part of a continuous process, I guess, is the point I want to make.
Thank you for both of your answers. In the bill, that sets out that there'll be regulations on the form and information on what the Registrar General will be able to collect, and you've already touched on that. And I'll come back to the issue of young people in a moment, if the convener allows. But on the regulations for the Registrar General, would you be prepared to publish the regulations ahead of the bill being finished at stage two?
The point of those regulations, I think, is to allow scope for things to be tweaked even after the bill's finished, just in terms of the detailed operation of the process. And that's, I don't think, all that unusual, as the Registrar General said when he was giving evidence here. I mean, he has all sorts of powers in terms of tweaks that he can make through secondary legislation. So that's the type of thing. We don't currently have specific things that we anticipate there would be regulations made around. But as I said earlier, it would not be the fundamental basis on which GRCs are being issued.
Okay. Thank you. And my further question around the Registrar General touches on the issue of age as well. The Registrar General and the Commissioner for Children and Young People both spoke of the need for support. And the Registrar General, I think, said that there had been conversations with the Cabinet Secretary on the sort of support and organisations who would provide that to people so that they could understand the effect of a gender recognition certificate. Could you set out, Cabinet Secretary, what those conversations have been, who you think those organisations might be? And I note that you've mentioned it could be approximately £350,000 to set that up and then £150,000 ongoing. That for some support, that could actually be considered quite small. So could you set out the detail that you've gone into on that and the role that young people will have in developing some of those supports and guidance?
Yeah, so I know the Children's Commissioner was quite clear that they thought that young people should be involved in the development of the guidance. And I think there's some merit in that to make sure that it is clear and straightforward. The Registrar General will have a particular role in making sure people understand what is in the guidance. They can offer face-to-face meetings. Where there perhaps is a role for other organisations rather than the Registrar General is where it is more about further support if a young person is needing support beyond just understanding the process. And I think that's where other organisations could have an important role, and that the Registrar General would signpost those. Now, what I would envisage is that when the development of the guidance that there will be organisations that would be part of that signposting. In terms of the money, obviously the bill sets out what we think the operating costs of the Registrar General will be. However, the door is not closed if it is shown that actually there needs to be either further resources, either for the Registrar General or indeed other organisations that are going to support 16 and 17-year-olds in helping to them to work their way through this process. So I think there's lots of scope for the development of that guidance involving young people, and I'm certainly happy to keep the committee informed about the progress of that, if that would be helpful.
Yes, I think that would be helpful. Thank you, Cabinet Secretary. There's also the Commissioner spoke about the presumption in the Children's Bill that children have capacity to share their views and young people have capacity with the court. Would you suggest that something similar could be helpful in this bill?
So explain that to me again.
So in the Children's Bill, there is an assumption that a young person has the capacity to make a decision unless someone else, on a case-by-case basis, unless a professional says otherwise. Yeah. Would you consider that that would be a useful addition to this bill to protect?
Well, I think that is assumed, I mean, due to the age of legal capacity, really establishing that young people from 16 upwards have the ability to enter into legal contracts. Now, I know that there are various ages for various things. I understand all of that. But I think the fact that we have agreed that from 16 years onwards, young people are able to make those decisions for themselves and have the legal capacity. Now, there are issues for the Registrar General around capacity more generally, not just young people, but if it was anyone who they were concerned about whether they had capacity or were being coerced in any way, clearly they are able then to take steps in terms of the sheriff court, etc. But for young people, we think that it is very much in line with the age of legal capacity and therefore consistent with that.
Thank you for that. We've also, and I'll move on to a slightly different area, we've also heard from people who have transitioned and transitioned again, sometimes called detransitioning, and that there is a lack of clarity of process to do that within the bill. Could you set out what you understand, Cabinet Secretary, to be the process for people who transition and then decide perhaps to transition again? And could you also set out for us how you would protect those people from a criminal process on the basis that how would you tell the difference between a false declaration and somebody seeking to transition again?
Yeah, so essentially the simplest and best way in those circumstances is that they would take the same approach and submit an application under the same process, essentially. Now, the offence is about knowingly making a false statutory declaration. So if at the time of making the statutory declaration you intended to live permanently in your acquired gender, then you would not be committing an offence if your intention to do so subsequently changed at some point in your life for whatever reason. And I think you could draw a comparison with marriage, which involves a lifelong commitment and intention at the time, but sometimes that relationship comes to an end and doesn't make the marriage itself false. It's just that someone has reached a different point in their life. So I think that is the simplest way, which would enable someone who has a change of view at some point in their life to be able to use that process. It doesn't happen very often, and the evidence, maybe some Peter was about to say, but the evidence from other countries are that a very small number of people do that. So there's not lots of people, but a very small number of people. Peter?
Yeah, sorry, I just wanted to add a tiny detail, which is that, under the bill, if you were wanting to reverse the process, you would just apply again. And that's exactly how it works at the moment in terms of the current gender recognition process, that you would apply and go through the same process. But obviously, currently, that's a two-year period in which you have to provide medical evidence. And our understanding is that the providing medical evidence for reversing the decision is a really significant barrier. So it should be much easier under this bill.
Thank you. That's really helpful. The other area that I'm interested in...
Cover those two areas. I think there's other folk wanting to come in on those. Is that okay? And we'll come back to you after. Is that,
yeah, I have some other questions.
That's fine.
Thanks.
So I think just we're going to have a comfort break in a little while, but if any members have questions, supplementary questions around the kind of point in terms of transitioning, detransitioning, retransitioning, or young people. So I think, Karen, were you wanting to, I think you indicated first, yeah.
Yes, thanks, convener. In regards to lowering the minimum age to obtain a GRC, other countries do have a lower age limit and some with no age limit at all. Can I ask how the process for the policy came about to settle on age 16?
Yeah, so I think as I've alluded to earlier in the session, this was probably the area that I gave most consideration to, because clearly it's a significant step moving away from the current process of 18 to 16. So we looked at the international comparisons, and some are 16, some are 18. Some require additional measures for 16, 17-year-olds, some do not. So we had a range of international examples to look at. And then I think we brought it back to two other things. One is, well, what in Scottish, the Scottish legal context, what else have we done in Scotland in terms of other legal responsibilities? And I think the fact of the age of legal capacity, Scotland Act 1991, was really important, because it gives legal capacity to 16, 17-year-olds to enter into any transaction having legal effect. So for me, that was quite an important area of the law that essentially fits quite well with that ability to make that statutory declaration. And then finally, it was the evidence of young trans people themselves who were saying that they're at a pivotal point in their life at 16, 17, when they're about to enter, you know, college, university, the world of work, and they wanted to be able to do that in a way that aligned with how they were living their life, and to have their documentation all in aligned rather than differing documentation, and I thought that was quite a powerful argument. So taken in the round, that was why I made that decision.
That's great, thank you.
And Rachel Hamilton, please.
Thank you, convener. There were just three points to pick up on, supplementals to Pam Gossel's questions. I just wanted to ask you, Cabinet Secretary, why the Scottish Government bill team meeting with the committee, that first meeting on the 15th of March, wasn't fully minuted. You probably can't answer that just now. And how, when you say that we've had plenty of time to scrutinise the bill, that on the 17th of May, less than 12 hours after the deadline for written submissions on the midnight 16th of May, with 10,800 short submissions were given, that you believe that the committee have had the ability to scrutinise this. And we have, looking at the passage of bills within the committee, had the most evidence sessions and probably the most private sessions within it. So to Karen's question, my question would be, what would be the consequence of not delaying the bill? And lastly, the point that you make about the impact on safe single spaces, safe spaces. We heard evidence from Senator Regina Doherty, who says that two women identifying as men after they had been arrested and charged and housed in women's prisons in Limerick. I wanted to ask you whether you were sympathetic to the concerns of vulnerable women housed in prison.
So just before Cabinet Secretary, you respond, I think there was a point which was more for me actually rather than for you. Obviously right at the start, the committee agreed to hear from the bill team in private as an introduction to the bill. That was a decision that the committee took at that time. It was unanimous. Obviously, Ms Hamilton was not a member of the committee at the time, but as is the correct procedure with the Parliament, a minute is not taken of private sessions. However, a note of that session was published, and I just don't think that was really fair. I've put that to the Cabinet Secretary, because it was really for us as a committee. We took a decision, albeit prior to your attendance. So, Cabinet Secretary, back to you.
I was going to say that, you know, the issues of meetings and how they're recorded and how the committee manages its business are not matters for me. In terms of prisons, I think the committee received some very detailed evidence from the Scottish Prison Service. Obviously, our prison service and the way we manage prisoners, trans prisoners or anyone else, is for the Scottish Prison Service. I can't really comment on another country's prison service, but what I do know is that the Scottish Prison Service are already making decisions about how to manage trans prisoners along absolutely on the basis of the risk assessment of that person, both in terms of the risk to themselves or the risk to others. So it's already the case that trans women may be held in the male estate or the female estate, depending on that risk assessment. Trans men, for example, 75% of trans men are held in the female estate, I think with a recognition that actually the risk to themselves has been deemed to be a factor there now. So they do that already, so that's the current process, and that will continue after this bill. They also have a review ongoing where they are looking at their gender identity policy and looking at whether any further changes need to be made, and I think they're looking at evidence gathered from their own prison population, service users, stakeholders, and they are looking to publish an updated policy thereafter once they've gone through that process.
I think it would be useful, Convener, if we did get a sight of what the risk assessment you're talking about is, because in Ireland they're basically not turned back anyone that's applied for a GRC. So therefore those individuals were given a GIC and obviously there was a risk because they were violent people, but they still got into the women's prison.
Right. So let me be very clear. The Scottish Prison Service has been very clear that whether or not someone has a gender recognition certificate is not the issue here. So they could have a gender recognition certificate and still be placed in the estate that is not in line with their acquired gender if that is the risk that is assessed. So the Prison Service could not be clearer about that. So, I think they are already operating that policy and have done for some time.
Is that because you believe that a GRC changes a person's sex for the purpose of Section 11 of the Equality Act?
Well, people have been able to change their sex through the 2004 Act since then, so they've already been able to do that. So any prisoners we're talking about have already done that through the 2004 Act, because this bill isn't in place. So any people we're talking about here, whether if they have a GRC, will have one through the existing 2004 legislation. The point I'm making is that the Scottish Prison Service don't give, it's not a pass, so you have a GRC, it's not a pass for a trans woman into the female estate or for a trans man in the male estate. What matters is the risk assessment of that individual and whether, not just whether they pose a threat to other people, but whether they're at risk themselves. And clearly you could see, particularly in the case of trans men, why that might be the case, which is why 75% of trans men are held in the female estate.
How many is that?
There are 16 transgender people in custody across the whole estate at the moment.
Thank you. And the last point about the 12 hours between the
the written submission and the bill being brought forward in front of the committee. It was quite a quite a short time to be able to digest 10,800 submissions to make a decision on who we bring forward for witnesses.
I mean, that's really a matter for the committee. It's not a matter for me. I mean, how the committee operates its business and the time you allocate for this bill is really for yourselves, not for me.
So you wouldn't mind if we did take longer?
Well, you know, I've made my views clear that I think this process, the consultations, the bill, and all of what was going around scrutinising this before it even reached this committee. I think we know what the issues are. I think everybody has had a chance to give their view. I don't think there would be any major changes or benefit from delaying any further. I think really we need to get on with this, and that would be my view.
OK, and all of that is matters which the committee can discuss in drafting our Stage 1 report. On that basis, I'm going to suspend proceedings now for 10 minutes for a comfort break, and we'll reconvene at 25 to 12. Thank you. Thank you. We'll now reconvene the session with a question from Fulton MacGregor, please.
Thank you, Convener. Good morning, Cabinet Secretary and your officials. I've got a few areas I want to ask some questions on, but firstly I'd just like to comment on some of the commentary on the at the end of the session before the break, and that was around the scrutiny of this bill. And I want to put on record, because I don't think it's been so yet, particularly not in this session, my thanks to the clerk and team here, who I think have done an absolutely fantastic job of making sure that we've been able to scrutinise this bill to the level and impact that we have. And I guess, relating back to some other members' lines of questioning, it's going to be down to each member if they feel that they've had enough information in relation to making a decision for stage one. And that's an individual thing, but I certainly feel, and I can only speak for myself, that we have had ample information to hear from a wide range of sources about what this bill does and what it doesn't do. And I felt that it was important that that was put on the record so that there's not just one side of that commentary. But as the Cabinet Secretary has already said, these are decisions for the committee, so I do not expect her to comment on that. The areas that I was going to ask you about, Cabinet Secretary, I'll start with the provision that's in the bill to live in the acquired gender, as it's called, for 3 months now. I know you'll be aware of all the committee sessions. You'll probably be aware that I've been asking on this line, so it'll be not probably any surprise to you that I'm asking again. We've heard concerns across the board about this, that there's not really any justification for where the 3 months have came from. I'm wondering if you could talk about that and what would be your response to those concerns. Where did the 3 months come from? Where was that? Why was that particular time frame reached? And also, have you got any thoughts going into stage two? Obviously you'll wait on a report, but have you got any thoughts going into stage two if there's any thoughts from the government about actually removing this particular part of the bill?
Okay, well, thanks. Thanks for your question. So currently, as you'll know, applicants are required to provide evidence that they've been living in their acquired gender for a period of 2 years before applying, which we think is unnecessarily long. We have, as you have heard, a range of views from stakeholders and respondents to the consultation. Some feel that there's no need for any period of time. Others are more anxious that there should be longer, so it's about trying to balance. The three-month period of living in the acquired gender represents our view of what we think is balanced and proportionate, providing assurance that the applicant has already been living in the acquired gender for a period of time before applying, without, on the other hand, imposing lengthy barriers. And I think, I know the committee has heard from witnesses that applying for legal gender recognition is often at the end of a process whereby, you know, they've made other changes, perhaps to documentation like passports and driving licences. So I think in the round, it helps to demonstrate the applicant's commitment to live in the acquired gender for the rest of their lives. But I think important to note that where an applicant has already been living in their acquired gender for at least 3 months, so they might have been living in their acquired gender for many years, that they can affirm this in their statutory declaration. And therefore, it would not impose a delay on their application. So essentially, they would affirm that they had been living in their acquired gender for a period of longer than 3 months and longer. So hopefully that gives some reassurance that, you know, there wouldn't be any undue delay.
I think it does, but probably, I think quite surprisingly, because you've already talked, Cabinet Secretary, about the heated nature of this debate, but I think what perhaps came as a surprise to myself, maybe not to other members, was that there was actually quite a lot of consensus over this part of the bill, regardless of what side of the debate that people were on, and that felt that
that in essence there wasn't any need for the 3 months. I do appreciate that response, but I'm just wondering if you know, and going back to the last part of my first question, if the government are open to reviewing and looking at that, going into the further stages of the bill, perhaps stage two.
Well, look, I mean, I've set out why I think that provides a balanced and proportionate response to concerns that, you know, we'd be going from a period of 2 years to well, potentially no time at all. We felt 3 months was a period of time that isn't unduly onerous, and for many people who have been living, actually probably the vast majority who will have been living in their acquired gender for quite some time, will be able just to affirm that, so there wouldn't be a further delay for those people. Obviously, you know, reflect on any recommendations that the committee makes, but I do feel that it's important to try and keep a balance within the bill.
Thanks. We've obviously heard the range of views on this as well, but I would be very wary of describing this as a consensus on this issue. And I think our conclusion is that simply removing that period of living in the acquired gender would absolutely not be welcomed by a significant number of stakeholders.
OK, thank you. Thank you for that clarity. On that same provision, there have been concerns raised about the language that's used in the bill, and that same, you'll be aware of as well, acquired gender. That's again, we've heard quite a robust concerns raised about that. Do you have any thoughts on those concerns that you've heard? Have you any thoughts on the use of the language? We did hear as well, to be fair, a couple of times, particularly from academics, which said, you know, we're concerned about the use of the language, but you do have to call it something for that part of the bill. So, you know, I think the committee's taken that on board as well, but just wondered what your thoughts were at this stage.
So, I mean, I do understand the concerns, and I do understand how important language is as well. But acquired gender is the language used in the 2004 Act and other existing legislation to describe legally changing your gender. So we've used that language really in part to ensure that the provisions being inserted into the 2004 Act work with the rest of the Act, without the need to change references to the acquired gender in provisions that are not being amended, because that would be a lot more complicated, clearly. We'll obviously look at the recommendations made by the committee, but I think for the purposes of legal clarity and understanding, it is appropriate to use language that's consistent with existing legislation. I'm also not clear, as the academics you referred to weren't, you know, what alternative language could be used to accurately describe legally changing your gender. What is important to say, though, is that we don't generally use acquired gender more widely to describe the experience of trans people generally, and we would ensure that guidance and descriptions around the process uses language that is clear, respectful and inclusive.
Thanks, Cabinet Secretary. Convener, I was going to now move on to the 3 month reflection period, but I don't know if colleagues were wanting in on the previous one.
A trans woman raised the definition of an acquired gender and put the question back to the women in the committee and said, what traits do you demonstrate that confirms that you are living as a woman? And I just wondered, for the purposes of the bill, if we are to reform it and make legislation better, does the Scottish Government consider that there should be a definition of what it is to of acquired gender?
So I think living in the acquired gender generally means living your daily life in a gender that is different from your gender recorded at birth. And in the context of the bill, this is the gender you're living in when you make an application. I think what's important to recognise is that living in the acquired gender is an existing requirement under the 2004 Act. And I don't think it causes widespread confusion among applicants currently, so we don't envisage it would with the bill. The requirement, and I think this is important to say, this is not about dressing or looking a certain way. It's about the ways a person may demonstrate their lived gender to others. So ultimately, interpretation, is...
can you give some examples?
Yes, I can. I was just about going on to say... So consistently using titles and pronouns in line with the acquired gender, updating official documents such as a driving licence or passport, updating utility bills or bank accounts, updating the gender marker on official documents such as a driving licence or passport, describing themselves and being described by others in written or other communication in line with the acquired gender, using a name associated with the acquired gender, although change of name is, of course, a personal choice and not required, but it is an example. The gender recognition panel, as currently exists, obviously, I wouldn't be so after this bill. It does advise in their guidance for applicants that this may include, for example, having changed the gender marker on your passport and driving licence, or that your friends, family and employer know your gender. Hopefully that is...
Who makes that decision as to whether all those things are being done if you don't have to give any paperwork?
So we'll work with National Records of Scotland to provide guidance to applicants on the application process. They will, NRS will look at how they can confirm some of the aspects of documentation if required. I mean, it is a statutory declaration process, but if NRS have any concerns, they are able to use various methods to check documentation if they felt that was required. Peter, I don't know if you have anything to add to that.
It's the individual that affirms it through the statutory declaration, but then there is this process through the Sheriff Court to challenge or withdraw where there are concerns about either a fraudulent application or about understanding of the effects of an application.
Convener, I think this is a bigger supplemental than I envisaged, but this challenge through the courts, would that be through a family member or something? Is that what you're saying?
So that would be laid out in the bill in terms of who is able to challenge. So it is, it's a spouse or a child.
Yeah,
or...
so... In the bill, it sets out that a person with a genuine interest can make an application to the sheriff. It would be for the sheriff to ultimately decide who that would be and how that would be defined, but the explanatory notes do give the examples of the Registrar General, certainly, spouse, civil partner or child.
Mm-hmm. Okay.
But those are just examples.
Yeah. Thank you.
Okay, thanks, and back to Fulton McGregor, please.
Thanks, Convener. I appreciate that. Cabinet Secretary, moving on to the similar, provision, which is the 3-month reflection period, which I know you've spoke about already, and I think that came out of the further consultation that you've done. Again, we've heard some quite a lot of evidence from people that this reflection period isn't necessary because it's likely that trans people have been, living in the required gender, to use the language, as previously discussed, for most of their lives, and I've been reflecting on it for some time. And also, we did hear evidence saying that perhaps it wasn't enough time. So I guess that you'll say that the 3-month period, is again to balance that out. But I'm wondering if you can speak a wee bit more about that, and what the justification, the government's justification, was for the reflection period, and it's specifically been 3 months.
So, as you say, there's obviously various views about this. We've heard the view from stakeholders and respondents to the consultation who may not support the proposal, but for different reasons, either that a person has already reflected on this in their entire life, as you said, or that the period reflection is too short or not required if the applicant was required to live in the required gender for a longer period before applying. I don't think there, again, is much consensus on this issue. The reflection period, in our opinion, represents, again, a balanced and proportionate response before taking what is an important and life-changing decision. I think it provides additional assurance that applicants have considered carefully what they're doing and are making a serious and lifelong choice. The bill doesn't require applicants to reconfirm the facts and circumstances set out in their application, just simply to affirm that they wish to proceed. And there are other, some countries have reflection periods, some don't. The ones that do, most notably Denmark and Belgium. As I said earlier, obviously we'll look at the recommendations of the committee, but I think it is important that we try to balance the range of concerns as far as we can. And I think the 3-month reflection period, you know, could be helpful to just ensure people are, you know, absolutely sure this is what they want to do.
Thanks for that. Perhaps either yourself or somebody else in the committee could correct me, but I do think that Denmark are considering removing their reflection period. But as I say, I could stand open to correction in that. But on the reflection period again, and I hope I'm not standing in any colleagues' toes here, because it does also go into the age issue as well. We did hear some evidence from some stakeholders and panellists who suggested that, you know, there might not be as big a debate around a reflection period over the age of 18, but perhaps if we are lowering it to between 16 and 18, there should be a reflection period taking people from whatever age they are to over 18, and that should be the reflection period. And we did hear that on at least one specific panel. I can't remember which one it is now, forgive me, but I wonder if you've got any thoughts on that, what we heard, and if there should be a reflection period, you know, for the 16 to 18 year old group, which is different from the rest of the population.
I think it, for consistency and fairness, I think the reflection period should be the same. I think, from memory, I think the evidence from the Children's Commissioner, I think, was probably against having a reflection period at all, but I think they would be quite firmly against having a differential reflection period. I think if we are agreed and go forward with 16, 17-year-olds being able to obtain a gender recognition certificate through statutory declaration, they should be treated with the maturity that everyone else is treated with in terms of the reflection period. Having said that, there's obviously going to be the additional guidance and support structure around 16, 17-year-olds, which we think is the more appropriate additional support that perhaps someone may or may not require over the age of 18. I think one area that, you know, we are mindful of is for those circumstances where someone is nearing the end of life and where, you know, frankly, 3 months could be a long time, and the importance of, for many people, having their death certificate reflect how they've lived their life. I'm very sympathetic to that and very mindful of that. So, again, if the committee were making a recommendation in that regard, I would be really sympathetic to that.
On the differential reflection period for young people, I think it was the Church of Scotland that specifically made that recommendation. Any such approach, I think, would have to be justified quite carefully in terms of putting differential barriers to accessing rights. In practice, it would work quite similarly to the current process. So currently there's an 18-year minimum age for getting a GRC, but the process of collecting evidence can take 2 years, and applicants can start that prior to it. So they could start collecting evidence from 16 but not actually get their GRC until 18. And this proposal would similarly restrict people getting that GRC until they were 18. And again, we've heard from a number of organisations and trans people that there are particular concerns for young people around getting their documentation right before going off to university or starting jobs or what have you, and preventing them doing that until they're 18, I think, would be unfortunate.
Thanks very much, Cabinet Secretary and Peter, for those responses. I mean, I think it goes without saying that, you know, when we're asking questions here, in particular in relation to that, doesn't necessarily reflect my views as an individual. But I think when we hear concerns, it's important that, you know, we put them to the government going forward. Convener, I was going to move on to my final area of questioning, which is ordinarily resident. But again, if there's somebody else wanting to come in on the 3-month reflection period, perhaps now is the best time.
I think if you want, well, is there anybody else who wants to come in on that? No, I think you yourself and I think Pam wants to come in on the ordinary resident as well. So if you start, then we'll go to Pam and then we'll move to the next.
Okay, thanks. Cabinet Secretary, on the ordinary resident issue, obviously the bill provides that only those born in Scotland or ordinarily resident in Scotland may apply for a GRC, but we have heard some concerns that this might lead to people from the rest of the UK travelling to Scotland to apply for a GRC. Do you think that these concerns are founded? Is there any international evidence which would back up or dismiss these concerns? I had initially hoped that maybe, given the similar border situation, that the Irish example might have shed some light on that last week, but I think once the Senator explained or pointed out the current differences here, it perhaps wasn't the best example, but I wonder if the Government have got any other examples.
So the requirement in the bill is for the applicant to be the subject of a Scottish birth or adoption register entry or, as you said, ordinarily resident in Scotland, and applicants will have to make a statutory declaration to that effect. And ordinarily resident, as I'm sure you know, means that you live in Scotland with only short periods away, and the residence must be voluntary for settled purposes and lawful, and it's a common law concept that's routinely used in statutes, so it's not particular to this bill. It's understood in many statutes. It's also worth also just reiterating that if someone knowingly makes a false statutory declaration that they are ordinarily resident in Scotland, then they could be committing a criminal offence. Again, we'll work with the National Records of Scotland to provide guidance to applicants to make sure that they fully understand that. And I think I've noted the evidence from the Scottish Human Rights Commission, and they said that what I would say about cross-border impacts is this takes us back to what a GRC does and does not do, is that because someone has the same protection under the gender reassignment characteristic, whether or not they have a GRC. If they go from Scotland to England, they will have the same protections in relation to their gender reassignment in school, in work and in medical context, whether or not they have a GRC. So, you know, I don't foresee an issue of, I think tourism is, you know, the word you use. I just, for all of those reasons, I don't foresee that being an issue.
Thanks, Cabinet Secretary. Given there's other people wanting in here, Joe, I'm happy to leave for that.
Okay, thanks. And I think, Pam, you were looking to come in on this kind of area just now.
Yeah, thank you, Convener. Just following that line of questioning, we heard from a number of witnesses, including Just Right Scotland, that there might have been concerns for people who reside in Scotland but are not citizens of Scotland. Is it your intention that the bill will cover those people?
So I know that concerns have been expressed about whether asylum seekers and refugees in Scotland would meet the requirement to be ordinarily resident and therefore eligible to apply. And I am sympathetic to these concerns. As you know, asylum and immigration are matters reserved to the UK Parliament and handled by the Home Office. Whereas we've got responsibility for things like access to essential services like healthcare and education that enable integration, this is an area that rubs up against devolved and reserved matters. Obviously, refugees are in a bit of a different situation in terms of their rights compared to asylum seekers. So there would be potential competence issues with the bill legislating for asylum seekers specifically, getting access to gender recognition, as well as practical issues that would need further consideration. So, Peter, I don't know if there's anything, you know, in terms of that further consideration, but...
No, not particularly, just that, you know, we're sympathetic to those concerns, but definitely would need to consider the competence issues quite carefully. And again, Colin, I don't know if you wanted to say anything specific.
No,
right, that's fine. Okay.
Thank you. Convener, I have some other questions in other areas. Do you want to come back to me?
Yeah, I think if I can go to a couple of other members who haven't had their substantive question yet, and we will come back. There is plenty of time. Rachel Hamilton.
Again, this is a supplemental which I had indicated that I'd be asking, Convener, on the cross-border effect. And I just wondered why
has the EHRC said that there are implications for potential divergence for the within the Equality Act on services? You mentioned a number of them there, but in terms of that cross-border employment, education, service provision, and on single-sex exemptions?
So EHRC have raised a number of issues, both in relation to their own position on the bill, obviously has changed, and in relation to a number of other matters. We've had quite a significant amount of correspondence back to the EHRC to really try and understand what the nub of their concerns are. I'm mindful that the Scottish Human Rights Commission have likewise had quite an extensive series of correspondence with the EHRC trying to understand the basis, the evidential basis, the legal basis for some of the concerns that they've raised and are continuing to do so, as are we, to try and understand what lies behind those particular concerns. Peter, I don't know if you want to come on the specifics.
Sure. I mean, specifically in relation to that concern about differential operation of the Equality Act. I mean, the Cabinet Secretary has recently written back to the written to the EHRC.
We've actually had sight of that.
Oh, right, good. That's great.
Night. Yeah.
On that specific point, it's really not clear what their concern is, given that the Equality Act is obviously UK-wide legislation. It's not framed around possession of a GRC or not. So therefore, it's not immediately clear why changing the process for obtaining a GRC would change how the Equality Act operated. So it would be helpful for the EHRC to explain that more.
Okay, so that's still to be looked at and delved into a little bit more then. Is that what you're saying?
Well, I think we just need to understand what their concern is, because the rights of transgender people across the UK are enshrined within the Equality Act 2010, whether or not someone has a GRC. So the fact we are changing the process for obtaining a GRC does nothing to alter those fundamental rights enshrined in the Equality Act. So we don't understand what the relevance is, really, because those rights exist no matter what process for obtaining a GRC a country has. So we just don't understand what the relevance is, I guess.
And I suppose, do you have another opinion on the fact that there will be different systems within that legal gender recognition?
Well, the different systems are just the process for obtaining the GRC, the fundamental rights protecting transgender people, which are reserved under the Equality Act, remain the same. They'll be the same the day before this bill and the day after it becomes legislation, if it does, as I hope it will. There is no change to any of those provisions within the Equality Act, and that's why we've written back asking for clarification about what that means, because we don't understand what it means.
Okay, and if you don't get clarification and understanding of that, before you want to go forward to stage one, or we create a report at stage one, what happens at that point? Is it relevant?
No, I don't think it is, because the rights are enshrined in the Equality Act 2010, so they would actually have to change the Equality Act 2010. Now, I would assume that that there would be what would be the basis of changing the transgender protections under the Equality Act 2010 for one part of the UK. It would probably not have a legal basis for a start to do so. So everybody has the same protections across the UK enshrined in that act, whether or not they have a GRC, and that is not going to change. What we are trying to get clarification on is what they think the relevance to this bill is. We don't believe there is any. I think that view is shared by the Scottish Human Rights Commission. It's not the only thing we've not been able to get clarification from the HRC on. We've asked them for clarification on a number of things that don't seem to have particular relevance to this bill, so we will wait with interest to see what comes back.
Okay. Do you want me to ask
So we'll go to you next, but I think it's probably for the record worth just flagging to anyone watching that we did have a session with the EHRC, so if folk want to go back, and a lot of these points were put to them, and folk can look at the recording on Parliament TV and make a decision for themselves. But yes, to Rachel.
Thanks, Convener, although obviously the go-between between the Cabinet Secretary and the EHRC has is developing in that sense, and so we need to keep up to date with that. I just wondered, in terms of the data gathering, we've heard a lot. We heard from Professor Alice O'Sullivan, who believes that, you know, data gathering is important so that we ensure that services are provided as such. And we heard from Senator Regina Doherty, who said a similar thing. But I just wondered whether you agreed with the guidance to public bodies from the Chief Statistician of Scotland, which advises only collecting data on biological sex in a small number of instances, which makes it impossible to monitor the impacts on women. And how do you see that being addressed?
So, as you say, in 2021, the Chief Statistician published guidance for public bodies on the collection of data on sex and gender, and is continuing to engage with a range of public bodies to support their application of the guidance. I know there's been particular focus on the recording of crime statistics, for example, and as you know, crime recording for operational purposes is a matter for the respective body, be that Police Scotland or the Procurator Fiscal or the Crown Office or the courts. And I think it's just worth noting that, you know, we publish the national statistics on criminal proceedings in Scotland every year, which are derived from data held on the Criminal History System, which is an operational database maintained by Police Scotland. And, you know, there are such small numbers involved here that I think the view is that there is not going to be a statistical impact from any changes that this bill will introduce. Peter, I don't know if you want to...
I would come in on a specific thing, which is that I don't think it's accurate to say that Professor Alice... Senator Regina Doherty was saying the same kind of thing as Professor Alice Sullivan, my understanding of what...
I would agree with that, but it was just two different views on data collection.
OK, but can I just clarify that Senator Doherty was very clear that she thought that the introduction of their gender recognition system in Ireland had had very little impact on data collection. Her specific concerns were around the kind of quality and nuance of the data they were collecting through their census and accurately reflecting trans people's lives. I think they were very different in terms of her concerns from what was being said by Professor Sullivan.
Okay, and I just wondered, you know, we've heard quite a lot about collecting data for the purpose of the gender pay gap, and I wondered whether you thought that perhaps there would be a concern if there wasn't accurate data collection that it could affect women's participation and representation in public life.
I don't think there's evidence to support that. I think Close the Gap had also provided evidence that I don't think supports that concern. I mean, the numbers are so small here that I don't think they would have a statistical impact. And, you know, the gender pay gap and the work that's going on through Close the Gap and the work on fair pay that the Scottish Government is leading is, you know, I don't think that this bill is going to have any impact on that at all, or indeed on public life, because the numbers of people we're talking about are so small.
OK, just because this is only my, I think, fourth or fifth session, had the Scottish Government done any work on that, analysing whether there had been an impact on services and resource and impact on participation in women, for women in public life?
In countries that have already done
this? No, this country, just sort of any analysis of how, you know, obviously there's a lot more people accessing the services of gender clinics, and we know that the numbers of people wanting to transition has it been increasing. So has the Scottish Government done any work on that impact, potential impact, as it were?
So happy to talk about the gender identity healthcare, which is a whole area in itself. Obviously, these are matters that are not to do specifically with obtaining a GRC under this bill. We don't believe there's any evidence of any impact where statutory declaration has been introduced in any other country. And I think that's really where we would look to in terms of any impact. In terms of the numbers going through gender identity healthcare, they are very small in numbers again, but are not related to this bill because someone doesn't require a GRC to undertake gender identity healthcare. We are aware of obviously pressures on those services and the further investment that the Cabinet Secretary for Health has made in order to try and improve that. But the two things are really not related. I mean, someone can access that healthcare without ever applying to obtain a gender recognition certificate. And similarly, someone could apply for a gender recognition certificate under this statutory declaration process without ever going anywhere near gender identity healthcare. So I think, you know, that comes back to, I think, one of the earlier points, that the two things are really quite different and need to be kind of treated so.
Okay, thanks.
Okay, thank you. And Karen Adam, please.
Thank you, Convener. We've had witnesses who have expressed their disappointment for non-binary recognition not being in this bill. We've also heard from somebody who transitioned and then transitioned again because they felt that perhaps non-binary was more suitable to them and how they felt and identified. And I understand the Scottish Government have set up a non-binary working group. So I'm wondering if you can tell us a little bit about the work that's been ongoing there. And could you see a possibility of legal gender recognition for non-binary people in the future?
So the first consultation on the gender recognition reform discussed legal gender recognition of non-binary people and the extent to which this would require significant changes to devolved areas of law, such as, you know, parentage, marriage, registration law, and also reserved areas such as the Equality Act 2010, as well as financial and administrative resources to implement. So very complex indeed, and that making, you know, such changes would require much further consideration and consultation if that was the direction of travel. So we decided not to extend legal gender recognition to non-binary people in this bill. You quite rightly have pointed to the working group on non-binary equality, which was established and has very recently made its recommendations to the Scottish Government, which we are considering and we'll be responding, and it will the report will be published in short order in the near future, next couple of weeks.
That's great. Thank you.
Thank you. Okay, thank you. And Pam Duncan-Glancy, please.
Thank you, Convener. I have a few questions in various areas, so I'll be as quick and succinct as I can be. Thank you for your patience with that. The British Psychological Society said that medical pathways are not contingent on the GRA. However, we have heard various concerns about health services for trans people, both in general in terms of healthcare, but also about their transition specifically, including that there are in some areas of Scotland 4 years waiting times, that there could be fees charged by GPs. And then, of course, there's the really poor health and mental health outcomes of trans people. Are you in a position, Cabinet Secretary, to commit to reviewing the health services for trans people? And what can you do to ensure that should they wish to access them, trans people can get a timely access to gender identity and support services?
So, as I alluded to earlier on, applying for and receiving a gender recognition certificate and clinical decisions about gender identity healthcare are entirely separate. So just to reiterate that, and we do recognise that, you know, referrals and waiting times for gender identity services for both adults and young people have increased over recent years, and that's why action has been taken already. The NHS Gender Identity Services Strategic Action Framework, which was published in December of last year, I think demonstrates a commitment to want to improve matters. And I think there was a £9 million investment, if I remember rightly in order to try and make those improvements. We do recognise that, you know, that is, it was a £9 million investment over 3 years, with £2 million allocated for this year to try and improve things. And there's a reference group that's been established to lead on coordinating this work. So it will take a bit of time, but we do acknowledge that, you know, the waiting times for support are not where we would want them to be, and that's why that investment is being made.
Thank you. I appreciate the answer, Cabinet Secretary, and I understand the difference and the implications or not of the bill on health services. I just felt that we have heard in a number of sessions about the kind of experience of trans people in the round, and I just thought it would be helpful and remiss of us not to, as a committee, to put that to you, Cabinet Secretary, today. There are a couple of reporting mechanisms in the legislation, and I note that the reporting mechanisms outlined for the Registrar General are considerably shorter, more restricted than that is collected elsewhere in the UK, for example, by the Ministry of Justice. Would the Cabinet Secretary be open to looking at further reporting mechanisms and data collection, including on people's date of birth status, etc., for the purposes of having a clearer picture of people across Scotland, including the number of trans people in Scotland?
So are you talking about what the NRS would gather, or are you talking about what we might gather in terms of annual reporting, or...?
Actually, probably both, but okay. Specifically, I think the annual reporting, and I guess my next question was going to be on the annual reporting, and whether or not that you would be prepared to commit to a post-legislative review, and also whether you would be prepared to consider in a short period of time the impact of including or not including non-binary gender recognition within at least perhaps a period of a year after the bill.
Yeah, so the whole area of annual reporting, I think, was driven initially by concerns that we responded to about being able to track and monitor the numbers of GRCs being issued. So that was the kind of starting point. But I'm certainly open-minded about whether or not annual reporting would go further than that. I think it has to be proportionate, and it has to be able to gather things that can be gathered. So we'd have to think about that. But I'm certainly open to suggestions around what else might be annually reported against. Obviously, in Ireland, they have annual reporting across a number of areas, on the numbers and a few other areas as well. In terms of the post-legislative review, I'm, again, very open-minded on that, if that was to be a committee recommendation. I think we would need time for it, for the new system to bed in. So there will inevitably be on the numbers a bit of a spike, as there was in Ireland in that first kind of couple of years, as people who are already living with their acquired gender would want to go forward with the GRC. And then it kind of plateaued out after that, and I suspect that's probably going to be the same, but useful to have the numbers through annual reporting. But if the post-legislative review wanted to perhaps gather information broader than that, then it would need to have a bit of time in order to be able to set up the systems to gather the information that we thought would be helpful in terms of what elements of would be reviewed. So hopefully that's...
Just very briefly, the way the bill is drafted sets out kind of minimum reporting requirements, and absolutely it would be in line with what's in the bill to provide additional detail where possible, and that's something we've absolutely considered. We'd need to discuss with NRS, and they are particularly conscious of, if we're starting to talk about very small numbers of people, that there might be issues around publishing a granularity of data. And again, that's picked up in the drafting of the bill. And just very briefly on this idea of potentially there being an initial spike of applications and maybe leaving it a few years before doing a formal review, it's also worth looking at the initial introduction of the Gender Recognition Act 2004, where for the first kind of 3 years or so, the numbers were very, very high. And it was only after about 3 or 4 years that it kind of settled out and you got a more accurate picture of how it was operating.
Thank you. In terms of data collection, I've heard evidence in committee, but also in other areas through the own engagement that I've carried out as part of my fact-finding on this piece of legislation, that there's an obvious difference between capturing population-level data and individual-level data. So the population-level data, I think we've just kind of touched on. In terms of individual-level data, there's some concerns around people falling off the radar for particular health services. And I appreciate, again, that this is not always directly related to the bill, but I think it is important that we consider for people who understand, and I also want to be clear that I believe that trans people do absolutely understand their bodies and are probably more mindful of their physical bodies than other people for various reasons. However, what more could the government do to be sure that trans women were called for the sort of services through the health service that they would need on the basis of some of their biological characteristics that they may retain after having a gender recognition certificate, and similarly for trans men? And I know that the Scottish Trans Alliance have got a mechanism in place around the CHI number changes that has worked in different areas. What's the government's view on how we could support that kind of approach to data gathering?
Yeah, I mean, I think this is an issue that, you know, we would want to pick up with health colleagues. Peter, I don't know if you want to add any detail to that, but I think it's a fair point.
Yeah, just that, yeah, it absolutely is an operational question for NHS, and one of these things that's not necessarily directly linked to the bill itself, but, you know, they should have systems in place that can cope with these kinds of changes already, and our understanding is that they broadly do, but they might not work perfectly in every instance. So, yeah, we're very grateful for the work of third sector bodies, but, yeah, absolutely, NHS should be able to cope with that kind of thing.
Thank you. And my final area of questioning, if that's OK, is around single-sex spaces. And I appreciate that we have had extensive discussion today and throughout committee evidence sessions on this. And in particular, I want to start with Section 22, which we've touched on, protected information. Can the Cabinet Secretary set out whether the government has decided that the bill doesn't impact on the exemptions, and whether you've considered whether there are a need for any further exemptions to Section 22, and what guidance would be issued by the government or others on this, in particular relation to the general occupational requirement?
So we're very clear that this bill has no impact on the Equality Act 2010 provisions, including the exceptions. Everything that stands now will stand in the same way after this bill is enacted. It makes it no impact whatsoever. And of course, we know that the guidance from the HRC has been updated, and that guidance has been, for public bodies to be able to use in terms of the application of the provisions under the Equality Act, and in terms of in practice, how is that? Because there are complexities there. It's complexities now. It'll be the same complexities post this bill. So that guidance is important. But there are no changes, to be clear, absolutely no changes to the exemptions.
Thank you. And my final question in the same area is around the prison service, and we have briefly spoke about that, and notwithstanding the comments on the numbers involved, which are small. Is it your view, Cabinet Secretary, that in the review of the Scottish Prison Service guidance, that a gender recognition certificate would not be considered as more of a kind of passport as it has been in other areas in the UK, but would remain a risk-based approach to the trans person themselves, but also the other people who are living in prison at the time as well? Would a risk-based approach still take prominence over the relevance of a GRC?
Yeah. So Scottish Prison Service is clear at the moment that if you have a GRC or not, it doesn't give you any enhanced rights of where you are placed. It's all down to the risk assessment. Again, I can't comment on other jurisdictions in terms of whether that's different in England or not. That's obviously not for me, but the Scottish Prison Service is very clear. So, you know, the review is to look at whether there's anything in addition to obviously what they're doing at the moment around the management of transgender prisoners. But they could not be clearer that, you know, and it shows from where they place people. The evidence is there. They already place people where they think it's appropriate for them to be placed, whether or not they have a GRC.
Thank you.
Can I go to Maggie Chapman, please?
Thanks very much, Joe. Thank you for your comments so far, Shona. Just to pick up on something around the Section 22 of the GRA and the one of the questions that we've had put, or one of the potential concerns that we've had put to us, is that with overseas gender recognition and confirmatory GRCs, although there's no obligation to require no obligation for somebody with an overseas gender recognition to obtain one, does that give you any cause for concern for people who do have a gender recognition certificate from somewhere else in the world coming to Scotland, and because of the lack of requirement for any need for evidence provision or anything like that, how difficult would it be for employers to obtain information under protected information provision of Section 22? So just a question around concerns for employers gaining access to information they might need around safety and that kind of thing for people who come with GRCs from other countries.
Okay, so given that as a general principle, GRC obtained overseas would be recognised in Scotland, in theory, confirmatory GRCs should not be widely needed.
Okay.
The bill provides for them in cases where someone's having difficulty obtaining this recognition or wants clear evidence of the legal recognition of their lived gender. So perhaps someone fleeing a war-torn country, for example, okay, where they don't have access to records. It's going to be a tiny, tiny number of cases, but it's a provision with that kind of thing in mind, as I understand, Peter, is that...
Yeah, right? Actually, Colin, yeah.
Colin, right, on you go.
There was an example in relation to the Fukushima nuclear disaster in Japan,
right,
where various records were destroyed and irretrievable, and so that was an example. And then considering the confirmatory GRC provisions, the type of example, complete destruction of records in a different country.
Yeah.
I think another aspect in relation to Section 22, if I might just add, is there's no substantive change made to Section 22 by the schedule of the bill. Protected information still relates to an application for a GRC or a person's acquired gender before the GRC is issued.
And I suppose the concern is because that information is protected, can you see an instance where some information that we would maybe want disclosed in terms of public safety or anything else would not be because it is protected?
No, absolutely. In cases where there may be criminal investigations or concerns about criminality, those would be areas where that would be disclosed. So those are the kind of areas where...
That's correct. Yeah. In terms of the exemptions to Section 22, preventing and investigation of crime is one of the exceptions listed in Section 22. That's correct.
Yeah. Okay.
On the Section 22 exceptions, I think it's probably true that we're generally kind of open to conversations about whether additional exceptions are needed on Section 22. But our view is that probably this bill wouldn't be the best way to do that, given that this bill is focused on the process for obtaining a GRC, mm-hmm, not the effect of a GRC and how it works.
Yeah.
Okay, that's helpful.
Okay, thanks. And Pam Gossel.
Thank you, Convener. I've got a supplementary, then I've got an actual question. Just on the back of what Pam Duncan-Glancy, my colleague, has been talking about, single-sex spaces. Cabinet Secretary, obviously listening to yourself today, that you've made it clear that certain things, especially single-sex spaces, are not affected by this bill. So just going back to that, do you think the government or yourself could have done something differently to help those people that are opposing the bill to better understand what it does and doesn't do? So is there anything, lessons learned from this that we can go back to that, because there's a lot of concerns out there, and I certainly know people stop me in the streets, in my constituency areas. And so Is there anything that we've learnt from this if we're not going to be suspending this stage one and we are going ahead? Yeah.
Well, I mean, I've tried to speak as much about what this bill does not do as what it does do. I have said so many times, particularly in relation to the Equality Act 2010, that this has no impact on the Equality Act 2010, because it couldn't have, because it's a reserved act anyway. but we wouldn't want it to, because we think the exemptions are important. So I've tried to do it. I think we all have a responsibility, to be honest, to try to set out not just what the bill is about, but what it's not about. Now, difficult to do that in, you know, on social media, because, you know, it's just difficult to have a conversation on social media, and by the nature of social media. We have tried to continuously try to put key points across in terms of our interaction with the mainstream media. When I made the statement to Parliament, I tried to set out as much about what this bill was not about as what it was about. There are always lessons to be learned in anything that we do around anything, and we'll always try to do that. But the debate, the discussion around this is a very polarised one, and, you know, sometimes even if you say things over and over again, it doesn't mean people are going to accept that. And there's not an awful lot I can do about that other than to reiterate and try to reassure that is the case. Ultimately, the practice of what actually happens in terms of people's concerns, I hope, will be allayed by what happens in practice when the bill, hopefully, becomes legislation. And if you look at other countries, that should be reassuring to see that, you know, those other countries that have gone down the statutory declaration route have not seen some of the concerns that were expressed in their countries as well, that they've not seen those come to fruition. So I guess that's really my hope, that once people see it working in operation, the tiny numbers involved, that doesn't impact in the way that people, some people might fear, that will help to allay their fears.
Thank you, Cabinet Secretary. Just can I ask my main question, please? Thank you, one of them. Cabinet Secretary, you mentioned obviously looking at other countries, so my question's around that. One of the concerns that were raised in previous committee sessions when we were taking evidence was about an issue on data collection on the basis of gender, as opposed to sex, and potential impact this will have equally measures such as gender pay gap, so talking about the gender pay gap. And I asked this question to Senator Docherty from Ireland to see that if they've had any problems on the introduction of self-ID policy, if that resulted in any concerns. And Senator replied by saying that this is something that was missed out at the time and it wasn't brought to light. But however, now she felt that it was something that she had to look at, that there's a gap there. And I just wanted to understand what your thoughts about that is, about the gender pay gap and data collection.
Well, I think Peter referred to this earlier on, that we understand that the Senator's concerns were raised in relation to their census questions.
Yeah, I would look really carefully at what exactly the Senator was saying, because I think it would be possible to misinterpret, and it may be worth clarifying, actually. But my understanding of what she was saying was not that the bill had impacted on collection of sex and gender type information, but that their census processes and the other processes for collecting data was not fully reflecting the lived experiences of trans people and the nuance of the questioning that they were making. It was a very different concern. And I would also just highlight the evidence that the committee took from Dr. Kevin Guyon, who'd looked at this specifically and concluded that this type of information collection continues to be and has kind of always been on the basis of sex, but sex that is identified by the individual according to their own interpretation and not specifically tied to possession of a GRC.
Peter, I just want to go back to this a little bit, and Cabinet Secretary, please, and help me on, and probably people that are watching understand this a little bit more. When we had the evidence session, there was a discussion about that somebody that's, I have to get the terminology right now, that a trans person now that was obviously born as a male, that basically if they were on a higher salary, right, compared to the other women colleagues, how would you balance that out? Because obviously it could be a certain time in through life that that person, when born as a male, was in the male and was getting paid in that job. You know, as we know, there's a big gap in female and male when it comes to the gender pay gap, you know, the actual pay gaps itself with female and males. So how do you see that balancing out? So if they go, you know, they move over and they're a trans woman and other women colleagues working with them are on less pay, how do we work that out?
So that's obviously not directly related to this bill because, you know, that would, if there's a situation like that, it will be under the existing process of the 2004 Act. As I understand, Close the Gap in their evidence said that I think this, it was statistically going to be so small numbers that we're talking about here that it wouldn't have any statistical impact. I think Close the Gap and those in gender and fair, those working on fair work are far more concerned about the gender pay gap between men and women that exists across, still exists across huge areas of our areas of employment. And the numbers involved here are so tiny that they really wouldn't impact statistically on the figures. And I think that was, in essence, the evidence from Close the Gap, if I can remember rightly.
I think that's right. And also, it's worth just reiterating again that obviously gender reassignment is its own protected characteristic under the Equality Act, and so consideration of differential pay or treatment would be, you know, a valid concern under that as well.
Thank you, Peter. Thank you, Cabinet Secretary.
Thank you. Any further questions? Rachel?
Thank you, Convener. Yeah. We heard in private evidence, just going back to the self-exclusion of women, possibly for religious reasons. And one of the witnesses, and it has been published, so I can say it, had said, she agrees with you, Cabinet Secretary, said there'd been a lot of debate and polarisation and confusion around the issue. But she also raised concerns that there could be a postcode lottery for the services. And she cited a shopping centre where there were no female or male changing facilities. And so she was saying that this individual was self-excluding from that. So I just wondered, you know, within the scope of the bill, if there should be a recognition of the individual that witness in private session had said that there was going to be issues in terms of that self-exclusion.
So I touched earlier on where the evidence is, and I'll come back to that specific in a second, but where the evidence is on this in terms of, I think it was led by the Scottish Human Rights Commission, they said that there was no evidence from other countries around self-exclusion because of people feeling uncomfortable. There's no body of evidence to support that in terms of where this has been done elsewhere. But in terms of the specifics, obviously you don't need a gender recognition certificate to go into toilets and changing rooms, so it's not directly related to this bill. But I think where most services are heading, and I saw, I think there was a piece of evidence that chimed very much with me around how changing spaces have changed over the years, away from communal facilities to more private space, which I think benefits everybody, to be honest, giving people that private space. So, you know, I accept there may be some facilities are on a journey towards that, but I think these are more about the, you know, the way retailers or shopping centres provide their facilities. I think people are keener to have more private space, like private cubicles, rather than one changing room, which, you know, back in my day when I was young, was a horrendous experience. You know, so it's not, I think we're moved a long way away from that, and that's a good thing. It's not directly related to this bill, but it's more about just what people's expectations are around when they're accessing services. So,
and I suppose it's ensuring that the exemptions within the Equality Act allow for inclusion, exemption, and modification in that circumstance.
Yeah. So obviously, under you don't need a gender recognition certificate to access the spaces that we're talking about, and you know, people, the trans community have been accessing, you know, spaces aligning with their acquired gender for probably as long as we've all been around, and longer. So the, you know, the exceptional, you know, the exceptions and exemptions under the Act relate to services that are, you know, services like the service that I cited earlier on, where, you know, it was about the a service to support victims of sexual assault or rape, that it is legitimate as long as it is proportionate to exclude trans women in that case. It could be trans men in other cases, but trans women in that case from that service. So, you know, the Act sets out very clearly that it has to be a proportionate response to the issue. And I think that's absolutely right. And this bill changes none of that. That is still the case.
And I think there is, if I'm being honest, having listened to a lot of witnesses in the private sessions, they've come to a private session for a very reason, that they feel scared to speak up. And just to quote this individual again, she had said, "I'm aware of the person who had decided to shop online after experiencing a male in a shop changing room." So, you know, there are people with concerns, and I think you do recognise that. You are recognising that within the evidence that you're giving today, and I, you know, I respect that, because I just want to really be clear that, you know, there, as you say, there are polarised views on this, and even this is for this to kind of reform gender recognition, there has to be a recognition also that there is a fear, and I do think you get that.
I do. I would just reiterate that this bill doesn't change any of that. And I think...
I know, like, but we keep talking about that. We do keep talking about that and repeating that and repeating and repeating that. And I have said in evidence a couple of times that I just wonder whether the Equality Act, within those exemptions, is meeting that reform that we're seeing now within governments.
Well, I think it does, because it requires a proportional response, and that people are not excluded in a disproportionate way. The only other observation I would make is that I think the private space that the committee has created has been a very good one, both for people to be able to express views who are concerned about the bill, but also people from the trans community who feel very excluded and affected very deeply by some of the debate and that has been going on. And I think it's provided a space for anyone who would rather, you know, be able to give their view and opinion in a private space. And I would commend the committee for having done that. I think it's clearly allowed you to hear evidence that might not otherwise have been heard.
And finally, on just going back to the criminal offence to make a false statutory declaration, I don't feel as though I've heard enough around that, because when we were in private session with the individual that Karen Adams spoke about, who had transitioned and then transitioned again, that person wasn't aware of any, you know, criminal offence. Would that person be subject to imprisonment or a fine if... in that case? I just need clarification on that, if you don't mind, Convener.
Well, not if at the time that they applied for their gender recognition certificate, that was clearly and honestly what they wanted to do. They weren't making a false declaration, because at that point, that was their intention. Now, if a year down the line, someone then changes their mind and wants to use the process to detransition, for lack of a better word, then no, because they're clearly, it was at the time that was their honest view. They weren't trying to mislead, they weren't trying to make a false declaration. That was their honest view of where they were in their life, so they wouldn't face a fine or imprisonment or anything like that. It's only if they make a false declaration.
Yeah, OK, thanks.
It's probably worth, I mean, from my perspective, some of the witnesses we took were using the word transition in relation to social transition or medical transition rather than a GRC necessarily, and using GRC processes. Any further questions from members? No. Well, Cabinet Secretary, Peter, Colin, thank you all very, very much. That brings the public part of our meeting to a close, and we'll now move into private session.